Hey guys, welcome to this week's episode of Trumpet Tip Tuesday. This week I'm with John Lewis. I've known you for, I don't know how long.
About 12 years.
Yeah. I first met him at the Burt Truax School of Trumpet Camp, which we're still here. This is Thursday, and it's been great hearing you every time, and it seems to get better and better.
Thank you.
Every time. So John is an LA studio musician. He's been doing it for so many years, and today we're going to talk about sound production and how to start your sound without kind of bulging into the sound and having it start right away. So take it away.
Okay, well, thanks for having me on this. I've enjoyed the ones you've done so far on this, on your tips. I don't think I have radically different ideas than anybody. It's just, you know, I come from a place of a real foundational approach to playing and always being cognizant of what's happening. Like I talked about this morning, you know, before you get to the mouthpiece, what happens in your breath, your preparation and your support and everything. And then the concept of when you play, trying to get yourself into a place where you have immediacy of sound. Like you're talking about the bulging, I call it bulbing, where if somebody plays and they either chew the notes and wah, wah, you know, something like that, instead of, you know, I like to do the crosshairs where this is your chops and that's your air, and knowing consistently some days it might be more like out here where it's like fa, fa, and being in tune so that when you start your air, boom, the notes just start. And we can teach ourselves to do that. I've seen people talk about just letting the note naturally start, something like this. You know, and not forcing anything, whatever. I actually had to kind of force that not to happen, mm-hmm. because my goal is to have my lips be supple so that if I blow air, it's gonna happen, and that's the attack. So if I put up the horn, it's just a matter of making sure that I'm in place, there's not motion there, and when I start blowing, if my lips are together, a buzz is gonna happen. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of the basics of it. One of the ways that I work on it or get other people to work on it is I try to get to where I know in the morning, if I start going and my chops are responding, the air is right in the center, I'm not chewing the note, you know, I'm just basically trying to go but with the tongue. And, you know, if you get up in the morning, I add another caveat that I'm not going to dive into here with the teeth closing, but I do in the morning, if I'm getting up, and I wake up and whatever, brush my teeth, and all my teeth are closed, parallel to each other, it's not my natural bite, and I'll just go. So if I can come pretty close to F and F above, I know it's probably going to be an okay day, maybe. But that's where I start, but we all have, if you can recognize in yourself how your body works and how the mechanics work, then I think we're all going to be better off. So if I sit here and Wayne Bergeron and I have talked about this, and I talk about this geek stuff with everybody that'll talk about it, but if I'm sitting here and I go, you can hear that. I'm sure you can pick it up there on the camera. That is the basis of your attack. Mm-hmm. And if your chops are not supple enough to even have that motion, then maybe it's something to look at. Because if I go, it's pretty much the same thing. And so this is like the sacred area. I think we have to protect your aperture. You can beat yourself to death, but we really want to keep that nice and supple. And so, trying to draw this all together, Jimmy Stamp used to have kind of a setup thing where firm corners, loose center, nice supple center. We all hear that, firm corners, loose center. But the tell is when you play with Jimmy, it's like if you played a low C and then pull the mouthpiece from the horn, the idea was, from the lips, the idea was that the vibration would be an octave lower. Mm-hmm. So if I was going to do that, I'd play low C. If I pull the mouthpiece away, so you can hear it drop an octave because they're pretty loose. If I'm having a stiff day, it might be, you know, it's not going to respond. They're not supple enough. But if beginning, middle, and end of my day, I can keep track of that. Just don't lose focus on it. Then I'll probably have a day of consistent response. And for me, not knowing what I'm going to do each day, it's really important to know how to read where you're at any given time. And I think these are the things that work for me, and I'm not just the ones that do them. You know, Jimmy's students, Malcolm and Roy Poper, have talked about this and do the same thing. Just making sure that no matter where you are, you keep that suppleness. So for example, I don't know if I'm going to distort this thing, but if I were to do something, maybe if I play that way, it won't be so loud, but if I was to play something that was a little harder, so here I am with the suppleness. Okay, that works. Keeping that. You know, because we all run into this situation, we call it, you know, flattening your chops out, where you're really bashing your face all day long. And after doing that, you're going to meet some resistance. Your chops swell, you're getting tired, start pushing more, and it obstructs what's happening here. So if a person wants to have consistency, they need to work on that consistency. They have to be aware after you've been bashing to not let it get to that extreme. Sometimes we don't have control, but we are responsible for trying to bring things back so that the end result is when you play, doesn't matter where. Like, you know, like Tomas talked about. Who cares?
Yeah.
Nobody cares what kind of day I had. They want to hear what you're doing right now. And I have to keep that in my mind, too. Nobody cares if you've done 12 takes of the main titles to Star Wars. Mm-hmm. They want to hear that 13th one perfectly, you know. Mm-hmm. And so if a player is trying to prepare for something, the number of hours that you do focusing on this contribute to it becoming part of your foundation, part of your playing. And you know, if a person pays enough attention to, you could call them the small things. Like, this is a small thing, I guess, but it's critical. Every note you play begins with an attack. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I can sit here and talk for 30 minutes, but when it comes time to play, do I have to take 30 seconds to play? Or can I never know if this is gonna work, but can I just pick up the horn? I'm gonna play it high C, buzz, whatever, but can I pick it up and just... Well, sometimes I can, mm-hmm. You know? And so success is based off of how often you can make that sometimes.
Right.
And it really needs to be, as trumpet players, as a professional player, I think we really have to be, think about a baseball player. They hit a ball 3 out of 10 times and they're heroes. They're batting 300. We have to bat in the really high 900s. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you have to hit in the 97 or more percentile. And it's daunting until you start practicing that way, that you're playing with that much attention. And for me, if I wake up in the morning, yeah, well, hopefully I wake up in the morning, but when I wake up in the morning, my attention goes to, like right now, I'm probably in the same position playing, you know, that I would if I were playing. Mm-hmm. I'm engaged. That's just what I do now because I've been doing it for a long time. So even if I didn't take a breath or prepare or whatever, I could probably do whatever I want to do. So, without taking a breath. because there's no breath, but it's still the same. Mm-hmm. So whether I'm playing full lungs or empty lungs, it really shouldn't be much different because the production is the same. Continuous airstream, attacking notes, it's just the tongue's interrupts are your ch-ch-ch-ch-ch-ch. It's not It's steady air, in my opinion. And all these are just my opinions. I mean, they're based, other people have similar opinions, I know. But not everybody is, and it's not a default. This is the way to do it. This is just the way I do it. So if I'm playing something and I can get a good attack, hopefully it's a good attack, but... still air is continuous, it's being interrupted by the tongue. But if I take a full breath, my lungs completely. So I'm completely out of air. It shouldn't sound any different. But the foundation of that would be to get to where you are taking a what I call an audible breath. There's the 1, 2, 3. One is audible breath. Two is engage, if you're not already engaged, or engage to a point that you're going to play. And then three is use continuous air. And that's pretty basic. But if you do that enough times, it becomes consistent. And then it doesn't really matter if one, two, engage. I like to think that I'm supporting, like, I used to say high C, but maybe G at the top of the staff, that's it, you know. And then three would be move the air through the horn. That's the mechanism that we do. So, and I try to do that. I may not do it, I may not do something like textbook saying, I might not do it that way. I might go, it's the same thing, you know. And I actually like to do, I like to sit with my lungs full to get them used to being full. And I can keep sipping in air to kind of expand it and make that all comfortable. And the more we can do to just get our body in a position of readiness consistently, we're going to have consistency.
Great.
That makes sense?
Yeah. It was all good information. So thanks for
you bet.
Coming on the show. I think the students are coming back from rehearsal. So that's it for this week's episode of Trumpet Tip Tuesday. If you're ever in LA, you should take a lesson with John. I learned a lot when I went out last summer. So
great.
If they can reach you, you have a website, right?
I do not, but I'm on Facebook, JonLewis. My website's still not up.
Still?
Still not up.
And what's your email?
Best one to reach me is CAJONLEWIS@yahoo.com.
Great. All right. Thanks for coming again.
Thanks for having me.
I'll see you guys next week.
Bye.